said, and I repeated, that our mathematical lives encounters every 100 meters the work of Professor Miller. I was never able to call him Jack. And for me, it's Professor Miller. And it's amazing because something that gets closer is the fact that I was a direct student of Lessius. Professor Miller was a student of Professor Fox, which was a student of Lessius, therefore that makes me stronger. But even with that, for me it's Professor Miller. And so what I'm going to talk about are modular groups over the Quaternions. And I'm doing this in this beautiful place. We're doing holomorphic dynamics in paradise. And here's a picture. And well, since the time of Gauss, one of the most fascinating and important objects in mathematics is the modular groups. Another object we think we found, like Professor Miller, we found often in every subject, from number theory to string theory, for instance, things like that. And of course, we all know that the modular groups is a consistent group of Möbius transformations induced by matrices, two by two, matrices with entries in the integers and determinant equal to one. It's PSL to Z, the modular group. The modular group, we all know, is generated by two transformations, T, which is a rotation of 180 degrees around the imaginary unit I, and the real translation Z equals to zero. So every element can be written as a product of their generators, not uniquely, but we understand this by understanding this presentation. We, instead of using T and S as generators, we use T and TS. We know that the classical result that the modular group is a free product of the group with two elements and the group with three elements. And this is the beautiful, one of the most beautiful. One understands the group by understanding the fundamental domain and the tessellation, crystallographic tessellation it produces. So this is the famous tessellation, and the fundamental domain is deep blue, which propagates and tessellates under the action. There's a better picture produced by Jos Leys, which is the one that makes the beautiful picture of KGs. Is this one? This was beautiful, but the other one is clear, I think. So this is, and the fundamental domain therefore is a triangle, one vertex at infinity and two angles of 60 degrees. And well, it comes to mind therefore, can we do a similar thing in the quaternion? In the quaternions, that is the division algebra of the quaternions, comes to mind. And therefore, we define, here I have a problem with, I have to use the letter H. And the H, the people in quaternions use this H before the people in hyperbolic geometry. So this H won't be hyperbolic space in quaternions. They use it first. And then, we consider the quaternions, the usual presentation, in terms of the canonical units, I, J, and K. And we want the analog of the upper half plane. Since there are three units, imaginary units, we want to be democratic. We don't choose any of them, we choose the real line. And so the half plane will be half space. Sometimes I'll be confused, I speak half plane, I mean half space, four dimensional half space, consisting of quaternions, whose real part is strictly positive. And I invite you to think as a floor, as a three-dimensional object generated by I, J, and K, and vertical, the perpendicular is the real, that's it. And, well, we consider H1H, here's, how do you call the H? Negritas, how do you call the
Ball.
It's about a bold face H. One H means one dimensional quaternionic space, which of course is identified with a four-dimensional hyperbolic space via the standard world coordinate-wise. Here, the one means that it's one dimension with respect to quaternion, but of course, four dimensional respect to quaternion. And of course, we provide this half space with a hyperbolic measurement. And, given any matrix, quaternionic matrix, A, B, C, D are quaternions, which is an invertible. Invertibility can be given in terms of something called the Dieudonné determinant, but actually we can think of this matrix A as an 8x8 real matrix, and therefore that's the invertibility can be put that way. And we compactify the quaternions H by a point of infinity, so that now it becomes S4, and we define Möbius transformations exactly the same way we define Möbius transformations in the complex field. But here, people like me have to be very, very careful. It's like politics, you have to choose the left or the right. And therefore here you see that I write in a very specific way. This order, inverse on the right, A on the left of Q, C on the left of Q, and precisely that way, you have to be very careful in this non-commuting. If you do that, then you use a standard convention of infinity, where infinity goes, and the image of infinity are the same one you use for the Möbius group, and you fabricate a group of transformations acting on the sphere. And it can be shown relatively easily that this group is exactly the group of orientation preserving conformal maps of the sphere, preserves angles. And therefore, to understand this group a little better, we can think of the quaternionic plane, H2. And G2H can be thought of as a group of, you think of them as real matrices? Well, then it's a precise definition of this group, SL2H divided by. So it's exactly the same idea as the modular group. The set of these Möbius transformations form a group, and you have the map that associates to each matrix, the associated Möbius transformation, and this is just stating what I said before. So now, of course, the Euclid sphere thought of as the quaternions plus one point at infinity contains the Euclid sphere, and so we want to know the Möbius transformation that preserves that. We play the same game that we play in complex variables, which are the Möbius transformations that preserve the half plane, which are the Möbius transformations, quaternionic Möbius transformations that preserve this. Do the same thing, no? And an easy calculation says that the set of Möbius transformations that preserve the ball are the ones satisfying this condition at the bottom. And, the set of Möbius transformations that fix the ball are written exactly in this formula 2. This formula 2 is reminiscent of the formula we learned in complex variables, which you know that one, for modulus of z0 less than 1, this is precisely the set of Möbius transformations that preserve the disk. And we mimic, not very hard to prove, we mimic the formula, and the novelty here is that the unit complex number is transformed into 2u, v on the left, u on the right, 2-unit quaternions. It's exactly the same formula, if you look carefully, except carefully written the order. And, if you count parameters, you see that v is a unit quaternion, so it's three-dimensional, three, and q has not known less than one, therefore it's four-dimensional, therefore this is 10 dimensions, and 10 dimensions precisely the dimension of the set of isometries of the ball. We can provide now the ball with a standard hyperbolic metric. And therefore this group that we we wrote before, this group here is assigned to. Well, it's exactly a group of isometries of a hyperbolic ball with this Poincaré metric. And this is a, this is saying the same thing. The compactification can be identified with S4, yes, the graphic projection. And ME is exactly a subset of the subgroup of the group of conformal orientation preserving conformal maps of the sphere are precisely those that preserves the ball. The group of conformal transformation phase 4, which was given by those previous transformations, you know, given by A, B, C, D, quaternionic, is 15 dimensional, which of course is the dimension of the group of isometries of H5. And therefore, this Möbius group, acting on the sphere S4, by the beautiful construction by Poincaré, totally geometric, you extend it to the disk, and therefore we have a group of isometries of H5. And therefore, any time I get a discrete subgroup of this quaternionic group, I get a four-dimensional, a five-dimensional orbital. And so that would be an arithmetic way of getting this object. That's what is written here. Of course, it's dimension 15 because it has transitively on the frame bundle of the sphere, so you count parameters, that's exactly what it is. But there's another interpretation which is very unusual. You take the quaternionic plane consisting of pairs Q1, Q2, and well, now you can write, you can, as I tell you, you can choose the left, you can choose the right. So you can choose the left lines or the right lines. So you take a point Q1, Q2, quaternionic, a right quaternionic line. This is what is exactly like we do, except you only multiply on the right. And therefore, what you have is a set for right quaternionic lines in the quaternionic plane is the one-dimensional quaternionic projective line, which is S4. And therefore, the matrices A, B, C, D act on right lines, remute lines, and that's another way of looking what I said before. And so this is written here: the action of 2x2 quaternionic matrix on right lines. I don't know if on lines on the right or LQ. I think LQ is left, but it's a little bit dyslexic. You have to be careful where you multiply and all that, okay? And, you know now, there's a relation between the twister space, P3, and you see any conformal map of S4, orientation preserving and angle preserving, acts in a natural way on the space of composite structures compatible with the orientation and the metric. And that is well known as a twister space. And so, and there's a canonical extension. If any conformal map extends to the twister map. So that's a relation that, so that gives a, I escaped some because that's, well, yeah, there's a connection between twister spaces, conformal geometry, hyperbolic geometry, five-dimensional complex element. That amounts to the richness of that same, in the same way that PSL2C is simultaneously of complex polymorphisms of the sphere and hyperbolic isometries, the same game. We're playing the same weight game. But remember, well, I was asking, well, if I encounter Professor Miller in every step, have I encountered Professor Miller in the modular group? And then I remember that I read a famous book by Bass, Miller said on Congress group. I don't claim I understood it. I took it out from the IHS publications. But maybe now I will use it because there will be a promise in Congress of using what I want to talk about. Okay, so this, so now what I want to talk is remember that I already told you what the isometries of the ball are. Those that mimic that formula. And now I take quaternionic half space. Remember that I choose the quaternionic as Lots of materials that have real part strictly positive. And, well, we can go to the ball, from the ball to the half space by the Kelly transform. The Kelly transform that used to be z plus I divided by z minus I becomes that one. The formula we need. Psi of q equals 1 plus q divided by 1 minus q inverse. And let you pass from the ball to the half space, play the game. And sometimes, as usual, it's better to see the round ball. Sometimes it's better to see the half space. Sometimes it's good to see the hyperboloid. Sometimes it's beautiful to see the Klein ball, etc. The same game, you know. Well, here I'm just telling you that the Möbius group that preserves the ball is exactly that the group that preserves the half plane via the Kelly transform. That's all I'm saying. And now, very interesting. Now, we take the subgroup of PSL2H. Remember that H is quaternary, not hyperbolic. It's always that preserves the half plane consisting of quaternions of positive real parts. So this will play sort of role like PSL2R. PSL2R, in the case of C, PSL2R, the Möbius transformation that was the upper half plane. So we want to find out that. And, well, it has a very beautiful story. According to Arefors, it was Karnatyov Varin, who was a very good person, but he introduced in 1901 the idea of using Clifford numbers to find Möbius groups of 2x2 matrices with entries in the Clifford numbers. There's a beautiful book by Arefors on that subject. And, well, he gives the condition of 2x2 matrices with entries in the Clifford algebra, which preserves the Wachenheim metric of the upper half space. In our case, we're talking of the Clifford algebra Z2, you know, and generated by one I and J. And, well, he gave conditions that were rather complicated, beautiful. But in 2001, two Italian mathematicians from Florence, Cynthia Bisi and Graziano Gentili reformulated the conditions of Arefors and reduced. So what condition the matrix A, B, C, D has to fulfill in order to preserve the half space? And it's beautiful. It's simply has to satisfy this condition here. The transpose conjugate is in the quaternion sense, change the sign for the units, satisfies that, replace this matrix. And these conditions are equivalent to Arefors, but are actually much better to use because they're very practical. Well, these conditions, if you do it coordinate by coordinate, you cover these conditions. A matrix, a quaternionic matrix A, B, C, D, satisfies, the preserves the positive half plane if satisfies any of these three equivalent conditions. So you see, you have several conditions. If you count the parameters, you will see that, it depends on 10 parameters. The group of isometries. It's beautiful, very easy to compute. Well, many of the difficulties in this paper are, apart from the H, because we have the H for units, Hamilton, quaternions, hyperbolic, we'll start lacking letters. Well, anyhow, these are conditions very practical to know. And so, BG, for in honor of BG and GD, the group of invertible linear transformations of psi BG consists of the orientation preserving hyperbolic isometries of the half plane, which is therefore the group of isometries which preserve the orientation. Well, the Möbius group also, the one that don't preserve the orientation, you have to put a Q bar, the usual way, the same way. Well, this group preserves it, the half plane, obviously act on the boundary. The boundary, therefore, the boundary is the set of quaternions, or see purely imaginary quaternions, the floor of I, J, K. And if we compactify with that point, that becomes S3, and therefore there's a natural identification into the isometries of hyperbolic for space with a conformal transformation of the boundary. We saw it saying, conformal orientation preservative transformations of the boundary extend by Poincaré to isometries of four dimensional space. Well, now I want to understand, to invent PSL to Z. And therefore, I have to know what Z means in the quaternions. Or I have to know. Well, groups which are generalizations of the Picard and Euler groups have been considered before of McLaren, Waterman, Liebherr, Johnson. Well, here's a little bit of the history of that. This is to make a point that what I do overlaps with some work, and we do it thorough and more complete, and we. Many things we do better because it's more modern, no? And so after that. So let's start by the affine group first before introducing the matrices of linear entries. Let's understand a little bit. So what is the affine group of quaternionic matrix transformations that preserves the half plane? Well, are those that fix the Hornock plane as high as one? Right, that would be the analog of A. In the case, there are matrices A, B, 0, A minus 1, the affine group. But in this case, a little more complicated. So the affine group is this one, which is much richer, they go commute. So it's exactly like the case of the affine group for the modular group, but you do it a little bit more. This I will go fastly, so we give a complete characterization of the affine group, much more complicated. And there's something interesting, which wasn't so easy due to the fact of non-commutativity of the quaternions. There's an Iwasawa composition. Remember that every element in PSL2R composes that as a diagonal matrix, exactly like that. No? And the interesting here is that matrix alpha beta satisfying this lower condition at the bottom is exactly S over R. So this is an analog. I haven't seen it anywhere, probably no, but anyhow. And that means that matrix alpha beta alpha satisfying these conditions here at the bottom is S of R. It's another presentation of S of R, which is interesting. But of course, physicists probably have a formula like that. They use quaternions all the time. Well, now we come to what do we mean by matrices, quaternionic matrices with integer entries. Well, we start by defining a Lipschitz quaternion, or Lipschitz integer. It's simply a quaternion having components. All those components are integers. That's related to it. No? And that is actually a ring multiplied to, so it's close. And, it's the notation here. This is the notation here. And this is actually a subring of the ring of Hurwitz quaternions. These are beautiful. Hurwitz was a great mathematician. Lipschitz invented Lipschitz integers in order to prove that they were integers in the sum of four squares. And so two great mathematicians, sometimes we know Lipschitz by Lipschitz condition, Lipschitz. Four volumes of mathematics, and Hurwitz, another great mathematician. He invented this this ring. So this ring consists of quaternions whose edges are either the top, all of them have integers, of all of them integers. So if one entry is zero, all the others have to be integers. So it's, and this is amazing, you don't believe it, you multiply two like that, you pay $1,000 and it won't be like that, it's actually a ring. And therefore, we can take now, well, it's amazing because it's a ring, but the additive part is a lattice, four-dimensional lattice. It's a little tilted. I think what it's related to the rhombic dodecahedron. It's a little tilted lattice, but it's okay. No? And of course, the Hurwitz integer contains a subring, the Lipschitz integer. And now I can think of PSL2HZ. It's a group of matrices with the analog of PSL2Z, but it won't preserve the half plane. But still, it's a lattice, and therefore, that way, We can construct two subgroups of hyperbolic assumptions of hyperbolified space and study their corresponding orbitals, which already by themselves would be very rich.
The question is the are the Hurwitz integers the maximal order in the rational quaternions?
That I have been asked that question, but it seems to me yes, but I'm not completely sure. In fact, that's one of the questions that I asked, that you know.
I think that's why Hurwitz
is. But I think it is. I think I couldn't find any other words. Wait, but that doesn't mean it doesn't exist, no?
Just if that's the case, one could argue that the Hurwitz integers are the correct generalization of the integers.
Exactly. Careful. And then I have to be very careful to see which matrix with entries there preserve actually the operator thing. Because now it's not like before. Well, therefore, you have to see when this matrix satisfies the PG conditions. That's what I want. Okay, so, but you see, I'm going to do it in reverse order. Since I know that the modular group is generated by one translation and minus one over z, I will define a group generated by translations by imaginary integers. I, J, K, an inversion by one. So let's see, let's do it by steps. So let's start by observing quaternionic translations. So quaternionic translations corresponds to the translations is when you put omega equal to anything. But if you want to preserve half plane, the conditions BG imply that omega has to be a pure imaginary quaternion. It's obvious you have to, you know, slice the plane, you know? So the group of translations that preserve the half space are precisely given by measures of this form. And now in the case of Hurwitz integers, you have to be careful. You want omega to be the imaginary part of a Hurwitz integer. But the imaginary part of a Hurwitz integer is not a Hurwitz integer, because it has a zero real part. But it doesn't matter, I define it like that. And well, here I just classified. I define the imaginary quaternions, and so this is the group of translations. Consists of matrices, omega, where omega, real part of omega is in. Simply I'm translating R3 with integer, no? Z3. Well, therefore this group of translations acts freely, and if you take the action, what you get is a three-dimensional trumpet, you know, meaning it's a cusp with signatures at infinity and has bounded hyperbolic volume at infinity and infinity. Just to tell you what, okay. And now comes a beautiful transformation. The analog of z goes to minus 1 over z is this inversion. And it's given by this matrix. Okay. Well, here I analyze, this is just words. This transformation does in the following. Think of the upper half plane, of upper half space, one, and it's an inversion around one. Take one point into some people. So it's an involution with unique fixed point is I. And well, these are just words to explain that it's a beautiful isometry, it's a involution of order 2. It fixes the sphere, hyperbolic sphere of radius 1, around 1, and there it acts as a typical map. Okay? So it's exactly like the modular transformation map, but you have to be careful now. Now, we are going to see the fundamental domain of the group of translations. You have it, you see, a complete analogy, geometrically complete analogy of the picture we have of the modular. So, this chimney, as we call it on the left, when you say chimney, okay, this chimney on the left hand side is the fundamental domain of the group of translations, very easy, but I just put it like that so to illustrate. And then you want the fundamental domain of inversion, q goes to q minus 1, is is what half space. It's the half space, I call that the igloo, if you allow me. So the igloo is the half sphere, which has maximum at one or radius one. So the igloo divides in two pieces, okay? And that's the fundamental one. If you combine these two, you get P. And P is a complete analogy with the modular fundamental domain. You can actually analyze carefully the angles and see that the angles are at 90 degrees or 60 degrees of different phases. And therefore, this is a polytope that satisfies Poincaré Poirier condition. And therefore, you can reflect.
This picture is three-dimensional.
It's three-dimensional. It's
the true picture.
It's a schematic. It's a schematic. Exactly. So the plane, the yellow plane, is actually R3.
And so this prism, this chip,
you have six.
It actually has translations in three different directions.
It's in the I, G, and K. Exactly. So, but I cannot draw it. So think of it, this is the Picard loop. So if you take only I and J, you come back to the Picard loop. But you use I, J, and K, you come to this. But this is just a schematic, but anyhow, this polyhedron. But actually, you see here I have four vertical faces. And in our case, I will have six. Because you, so these are, you think these igloos have a, I suppose, something to breathe. You take the top, it's a square. No? Breathe, I suppose. This is a cube, in this case a cube. No? This intersection of the project is this cube projects into the standard cube, into the imaginary. And therefore this, if you reflect that one, you get the third picture. Well, if I give a group, so therefore P tessellates, give me a kaleidoscope.
Kaleidoscope of R3.
But this group, of course, won't preserve orientation. We don't like that sometimes. And therefore, when a group that preserves orientation, we take the double of that. And this double pyramid, with one vertex at infinity and one vertex at zero, tessellates. Now the angle is 120 degrees, or 60 degrees, of different phases. That tessellates the group. And therefore, that's one way to get some, okay? And then we remember the modular group is a composition of translation and inversion. Inversion with respect to I. This time, inversion with respect to 1. And therefore, it's natural to ask multiplication on the left and to the right. And look at this beautiful, you see? So we've got L omega is multiplication by 1 omega 0 1. Let me use it here. This R omega. Multiplication on the right by inversion, multiplication on the left. So first you translate, and then you invert, or then you invert, and then you translate. And these groups, remember, one of the, for the modular group, this were for the three. And so, naturally, surprisingly, depending on omega, you have objects, elements of order six, of order four, and more complicated. And therefore, the group won't be the group generated by that won't be free product of Z2 with Z3. We have a complicated structure, but actually can be calculated. There's a machine given a polyhedron with angles, you can compute the fundamental group. It's called the amalgamated graph product of something. Well, here's observation that the order of L omega depends on omega. So sometimes of order 4, sometimes of order 4. So as a, you can analyze where are the fixed points, where are the order. In other words, you can determine what is the orbital associated if you apply one of these. Now we have a definition. The Lipschitz quaternionic modular group is the group generated by the inversion key and the translations with imaginary part, with purely imaginary quaternions. And we adopted by PSL to L, calligraphic L for Lipschitz. And one of the theorems says that these matrices are exactly the matrix in PSL2H, the set of quaternionic matrices with Lipschitz integers, which preserve the upper half plane. And therefore, it's a theorem like that. And it's a discrete subgroup. And in this paper, well, we completely characterize the associated order for this. Well, now, something important here will play the units in the group. The Lipschitz group has this surface of a sinking cell is this here. So it's peer reviewed. If you now look at the quaternions and take the units, well, they stay on the unit sphere, three-dimensional sphere, and they will create a regular polyhedron. So that's one way of creating a polyhedron. So it will be a record of the climate, Venice climb, beautiful polyhedron, which have 16 verses. You can make a football for dimensional footballers. But this is not very, there are some better ones, like the dodecahedron, but this is one. And now, well, now you have a unitary groups. Here you have more rich, you have richer structure because you have diagonal, you can take diagonal matrix where you use a unit. Well, I will define that in the unitary group, tell you exactly what the, how it acts, there are rotations. Well, and then you define the affine group. You see, in the case of the modular group, there's no, the only affine group is translation by one. This is because they're rich. The Lipschitz is a affine group, consists of elements U, U, B, will be, is a, well, of that form, you know. Well, so the Lipschitz, well, this is, I skip this, this we have a complete diagram. Okay. You see how we, it's essentially a description of the binary dodecahedral group in terms of whatever it is. Okay. But now in terms of matrices with integer. But the Hurwitz unit is a better, more beautiful. So the Hurwitz units are these cross minus one, cross minus I, cross minus. You count all possible signs, you will see that has order 24. So you have the units, Hurwitz units, are in the unit sphere. And form a regular polyhedron with 24 verses. And if you take a complex hole, that's one with platonic solids, and the faces are actually octahedra. And it's there are 24 octahedra, regular octahedral faces, at one vertex concur exactly six faces. And so if we now think of the model of the ball of H4, we have this Poincaré polyhedron. And therefore you start thinking of reflecting of, no, well, this will be very useful to you. So this group is 4 and 24, the units. And it's actually the binary tetrahedral group. Its elements can be seen as the vertex of 24, a famous object, 24 cell. One beautiful object. It's a complex regular four-tone polygon whose boundary is composed of 24 octahedral cells with six medians at each vertex. Well, here you have the combinatorics. You know? And now, of course, if you use the KV transform, you change it from the ball where we see it, the upper half space where we want it, you get. We'll see it later. Well, now, for the case of the unit, you have special subgroups. This is just a description of the special subgroups with integer, with special integers, or either Lipschitz or Hurwitz. And these are essentially the one that fix one. You see, the one that fix the top of the igloo is a very interesting. I'm describing that. You know, one is 4024, one is 4018. We have complete detail, and that doesn't happen in dimension two. There's not very much to see. And then, what's interesting is that there's a relation between the Lipschitz and the Hurwitz groups. So the Lipschitz group is a sub of industry of the group. This is just a small computation. And for the moment, therefore, we have created order, I tell you that there are surplus of an index, which actually acts freely, and therefore I get many hyperbolic benefits. And over time, we have the property of being arithmetic in the arithmetic. Well, here again, I analyze the Hurwitz. Hurwitz affine group. So it's a group of Hurwitz elements which fix the horrible and high one. And this is what I wanted to put in. This is the 24 cell in the upper half plane. You put U, a unit, a Hurwitz unit, and you get a 24. Then, once we have that, we understand all the symmetries of the 24 cell. This is a 24 cell. This is the projection into R3 of the 24 cell. This is, by the way, before I forget, this is joint work with Fabio Blacci from Firenze and Juan Pablo Diaz from Cuernavaca. And this picture was made by him. Then so the remark is the other is an analysis of forget about it, it's an interesting remark. The structure of the finite subgroups of that. But what is important is the remark. I have two subgroups which are discrete and possess the half space, and therefore they are hyperbolic climbing groups, which is a big Poincaré, and therefore they define two four-dimensional orbifolds, which will be the analog of the modular orbit. The modular orbifold is one of the most beautiful objects there is in humans. You know, it parametrizes the elliptic curves. And for the unit tangent one, you can even go to the Riemann hypothesis. So it contains all the mathematics. No, I'm exaggerating, but it contains an enormous amount of mathematics. And therefore, this orbifold should be interesting. Well, now, the fundamental domain for the modular group, we know how it is the triangle that I showed you at the beginning. And now, these inequalities give you that. It's a way to describe the fundamental piece of that. Okay. It's a schematic picture of the chimney, which is the fundamental domain of the parabolic subgroup. The one P, the polyhedron, both all of the polyhedron are Poincaré polyhedrons, and therefore you reflect them, you tessellate the half space, and I think it's going to be too long. Well, you see, all those words mean the following. P is, as John Hover says, a four-dimensional object. Its base is a cube, a spherical cube, right? Which projects to the standard cube in R3. And therefore you count how many words it has, how many things. In the similar structure of that. What the angle between the face, it's a complete description. So this thing here, forget about it, is a complete description of the angles, the incidence face, how many faces, how many edges, how many two-dimensional faces, this, you know? Because we want to understand the quotient, which is an orbifold. Well, here's just a reminder, I've told you 1,000 times, satisfy the conditions of Poincaré polyhedral theorem, and therefore, I'm saying here, so many words, I already told you 20 times, we get orbifolds. You know, I should have expressed this, it's already told you 20 times. Words and hands are better than. So all that means habemus orbifolds, say it that. Well, here, but the other important thing is that the Hurwitz orbifold covers it's a triple cover in the sense of orbifolds, ellipses orbifolds. Okay. Well, here fundamental domains, and here article, this is a proof I will work with. The proof that these are actually the fundamental domains. We mimic a proof by Sayle. Because the proof that that is the fundamental domain of the modern group requires work, not just. And so that's what we do, especially because non-commuting, when you have work, and you prove that it's, and this actually, this calculation is what we use to prove that the groups are actually, it's the same thing to talk about groups generated by translations and inversion as the transformations that preserve the upper half of these proofs. Well, now we come to the fundamental domain. So we have the pyramid with first at infinity over the cube. But now there are symmetries of the cube. That's where I went to so much work, so many times, so many slides that I didn't read about the affine group or the unitary group. It doesn't act freely. There are isometries. And therefore, the real fundamental domain is not the pyramid over the cube, but a pyramid over two cubes. Well, this would be a fundamental domain, not convex. If you want, you could do adjacent cubes, but it's much more. So this is the description of the fundamental domain of the Lipschitz. And this over here, on the right-hand side, is the fundamental domain of the Hurwitz. Okay? And then, you can cut it apart, your fundamental domain, you can cut and paste. And finally, a fundamental domain of the Hurwitz can also be seen as a pyramid over there. It's called the rhombic dodecahedron. So it has 12 faces, which are rhombus. And that's one of the few three-dimensional objects that tessellate. So this is another way. And this is the theorem. Any element which satisfies the condition which namely preserves the half space belongs to what we define in the special. We define using generators. The two things are the same. Okay. These two theorems say that. So these are complete characterizations of Hurwitz and Lipschitz. But actually, these fundamental domains can actually have some divided even smaller pieces. This, you see, this is the fundamental cube, and you divide into 24 pieces like that. And now this little piece, this tetrahedron, fits in the 24 cell, and therefore, what I want to do is take this. This will be my tiny piece in which I display, and all circles will be well. Too many words. Well,
can you go back one slide?
Huh?
Can you just tell us what the Kotzinger diagram is for one?
Yeah.
Fundamental?
Okay. So. I have the pyramid over the, you have a pyramid over the cube, the spherical cube. Divide that cube. So remember the picture of the you have a chimney and then the other one in the middle. It's a four-dimensional polytope bounded by a igloo and six vertical faces. The fundamental group, the fundamental domain for the Lipschitz group is not that, it's a smaller one, because this has symmetries.
But just to interject, I'm just asking a question about this three-dimensional picture.
Ah, sorry.
There's a three-dimensional finite Kotzinger group that's the full symmetry group of the cube. Can you just tell us what its diagram is? Is it B3, for example?
Ah.
B3,
I think. But I think that this is the real domain is the cone which versus at infinity over this. This is the fundamental piece.
Right, so that will have this as a subdiagram.
Yeah, that I don't know. but if I write my student, he will tell me. He's the expert on that. Okay. But I know the angles and I know everything. No? So if I work it out, I probably get it. But now you got me without. Okay. Well, anyhow, that's what it is. Well, here we have complete analysis of what are the angles, etc. All the structure of the thing. This is a 344. This 24 cell, they compose as a union of 1,152 of these little tetrahedral you asked me about. Okay? This will be the smaller piece with symmetries, I think. And you can compute the volume, and therefore, in four dimensions, it's not so hard as in dimension three to compute because of gas modeling. And these are the volumes of this volume. Can completely describe. Well, this is the way more or less we look, no? Just a picture. And then, Dawson, related to your question is, now that you have this fundamental domain, you can actually do the Kalin graph. And this will be the set of relations for the Lipschitz group. So it's not the free problem of C2 with C3, but it's much more complicated. And this, and I tell you, it can be reduced enormously. I mean, in fact, we know how to do that. So you see, it has elements of relations of order 6, relations of order 3, relations of order 4. It's a very complicated group, finitely generated group. That's the way. You construct the Kalin graph, just take a fundamental set and connect according to the group. So fortunately, the volume of the Lipschitz Hall 46 trap is 3 times the volume of the leak of the hook. So that proved that we were correct. And now what we do is take several covers of that, of these orifolds. Okay, here. Roughly the chance found 1,171 non-compact upper body for manifolds, which have already characteristic 1. And using this group, one can get a geometric picture of. So there is a subgroup which gives you a hyperbolic manifold of finite index with 5 costs, and such that the costs are therefore of the form T3, the ends are T3 times R, and you can fill them up so that you have the following result by Chan and Dabler. In S4, there is 5 tori, linked a little bit like Bourdieu rings, in such a way that the complement is a hyperbolic manifold. And this verifies that. But we do it now with arithmetic quaternionic arithmetic. And it's part of the thesis of one of the co-authors, on Pablo Diaz. And this is what I would say, hyperbolic manifold. So we make an analysis of different cellular groups to get this type of hyperbolic manifold. Which are complement, which can be compactified to be S4. A little bit like the complement of the fibre or the Borromean rings. Well, I think I'm gonna finish here. sorry it was too fast at the end, but all the rest is, once we have this, let me finish it, too many words. Once you have the fundamental domain, a good answer to a question that you have it, but you have the piece. Okay? Once you have that, you can propagate, and then you get groups, and you get manifolds, and then it has a beautiful structure. And last but not least, of course, there are congruous subgroups, and it hasn't escaped our attention that maybe you can construct modular forms, and you can construct relations. We have some ideas about Bianchi groups, and about many other things related to quaternions, use of quaternions for hyperbolic, for dimensional hyperbolic. Thank you very much.
Are there any questions?
Can you explain this picture?
Well, it's a tessellation. It's a three-dimensional tessellation. And you imagine that is, I think, for the picard. And it's a beautiful, it's the Prochnev who does it, and who gave us permission to use it. He's a beautiful, has beautiful pictures of every possible tessellation. No? And it's the closest analog we have. In front of me, we don't know how to do without pictures, no? But anyhow, it's a... by the way, this is just a quaternion. Is it me? Sorry.
Yeah.
I'm not quaternionic and I'm dyslexic, so I'm very happy that I was able to get something done. Sorry.
Any other questions?
So the Picard group, which is SL2Z adjoined I, has many variants, like SL2Z adjoined Eisenstein.
Exactly.
The unity and other, described by discriminants of imaginary quadratic fields. Are there variants of the Hurwitz integers of similar type?
Yes, exactly. That's my student analyzed that. The figure eight complement is related to the Eisenstein. And it's a really beautiful picture. And my secret is that I'm working on something you spoke about, the Hilbert modular quaternionic surface. But that's a secret, don't tell anybody. But,
but I meant in the quaternionic case, so it's a hyperbolic space.
Yes.
Of dimension four, is there another group, like SL2 of the Hurwitz integers, that's more general or different than the Hurwitz integers?
No, we haven't been able to find it. I mean, we start thinking, of maybe square root of 2, you know, taking the problem, but it's very rich. But you can think of this, makes complete sense, the geodesic flow, meaning one-dimensional, has many, I can take a quaternionic builder, why not? But that's for the future.
So when I build fundamental domains for things like this, I use isometric spheres, isometric hemispheres, and things like that. Are you able to define those things?
No, I have not. No, we know about it. Neither the Dirichlet nor the isometric spheres. We thought about it, but I think this way is more appropriate because, you know, it's the integers are embedded, this chimney, the integers are embedded there. The other ones is a bit more stupid. But it would be a very interesting question, actually. You know, isometric spheres or even Dirichlet domains, we haven't done. This is just the first step. And we were very glad that we were able to say something. You know, that's a very good that way.
All right, let's take the speaker one more time.
I also want to remind you.